please join me in the call to worship today, inspired by the biblically inspired lyrics of Bob Dylan. The line it is drawn, the curse it is cast.
The slow one now will later be fast.
As the present now will later be past.
The order is rapidly fading.
And the first one now will later be last.
For the times they are changing.
A new world is on the way, God's reign of justice and peace.
Surely it is coming, the dream of God for all peoples. Let us worship God.
Thank you.
disciples came and asked him, "Why do you speak to them in parables?" He answered, "To you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. To those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. The reason I speak to them in parables is that seeing they do not perceive, and hearing they do not listen, nor do they understand. With them indeed is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah that says, 'You will indeed listen, but never understand, and you will indeed look, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and their ears are hard of hearing, and they have shut their eyes, so that they might not look with their eyes and listen with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. Truly I tell you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see but did not see it, and to hear what you hear but did not hear it.'" This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do
everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
What is it about a simple piece of music, a song, that can reach us so deeply where ordinary words cannot? Oftentimes, no mere words, no matter how wise, can bring peace to a troubled heart. No words can make us feel the presence of God when God feels far away. But we have all had the experience of being moved, touched, transformed by music. Sometimes in a church worship service, sometimes outside of it. But either way, the effect is undeniable. Music, song, speaks to us from another place, capable of conveying the truth of God and the nearness of God that no other medium can. Where we have been blind and deaf, it can help us to see and hear. It was today's Summer Saint himself who spoke to this just last year, a songwriter speaking about the power of a great song. He said this: when you hear a great song, you get a gut reaction and an emotional one at the same time. A great song follows the logic of the heart and stays in your head long after you've heard it. It can be played with a full orchestra score or by a strolling minstrel. And you don't have to be a great singer to sing it. A great song mutates, makes quantum leaps, turns up again like the prodigal son. A great song is the sum of all things. It could be the turning point in your own life. It's timeless and ageless. It's a field power. It's blood and thunder. It's on easy street and in the land of milk and honey. It's everywhere. A great song touches you in secret places, strikes your innermost being, and sinks in. Today, our summer saint is indisputably one of the three or four greatest songwriters in the American musical canon, the iconic and iconoclastic Bob Dylan, whose career has spanned over 60 years and is still going strong. He's been fairly described as one of the most influential figures of the 20th century, both musically and culturally. Dylan was born Robert Allen Zimmerman in Duluth, Minnesota, in 1941, of deep Jewish heritage on both sides of his family, both sets of his grandparents having been Jewish immigrants to the United States, on one side from present-day Ukraine, and the other from Lithuania. Growing up in Hibbing, Minnesota, he and his family were part of the area's small, close-knit Jewish community, and he had his bar mitzvah at the age of 13. Unsurprisingly, he took to music early and was part of several rock bands as a teenager, growing up on and playing the music of Little Richard and Elvis Presley. But soon after moving to Minneapolis at the age of 18 and enrolling at the University of Minnesota, his focus on rock and roll, of course, gave way to a focus on American folk music. He began to perform at a coffee house a few blocks from campus, appropriately called the 10 o'clock scholar, and he became involved in a folk music circuit. He himself explained this shift in style in a 1985 interview in this way. He said, "The thing about rock and roll is that, for me anyway, it wasn't enough. There were great catchphrases and driving pulse rhythms, but the songs weren't serious and didn't reflect life in a realistic way. I knew that when I got into folk music, it was more of a serious type of thing. The songs were filled with more despair, more sadness, more triumph, more faith in the supernatural, much deeper feelings." It was also during this period that he began to himself as Bob Dylan, inspired as he was by the great Welsh poet Dylan Thomas. Finishing his college studies, he, of course, moved on to New York City and began to perform in clubs and cafes in Greenwich Village. And in 1962, he released his self-titled debut album of traditional folk songs, followed the next year by his great breakthrough as a songwriter with the release of his second album, The Freewheelin' Bob Dylan, which featured what may be his most famous song of all, Blowin' in the Wind. It really isn't an exaggeration to say that it was this song, this truly great song, and others like it on this second album that established Dylan as the voice of his generation, someone who implicitly understood the moral crisis of the times and the imperatives that young people all over the country were feeling. In addition to protest songs addressing war and racism, it also included love songs and surreal talking blues and, so importantly, humor. The sheer range on the album impressing a vast audience, including the Fab Four, the Beatles, before they were the Fab Four. George Harrison said of the album, "We just played, just wore it out. The content of the song lyrics and just the attitude, it was incredibly original and wonderful." Now, it goes without saying that Dylan's vocals, his unique singing voice, attracted a lot of attention. The novelist Joyce Carol Oates wrote this of his voice: "When we first heard this raw, very young, and seemingly untrained voice, frankly nasal, as if sandpaper could sing, the effect was dramatic and electrifying. His unique sound soon became wholly identified with him, inseparable from his public persona, which almost overnight became larger than life." But for all the appeal of his unique voice, it is true that there are many Dylan songs that folks know best because of covers by other artists. "You Could Be Forgiven," for example, for not knowing that "All Along the Watchtower" is actually a Dylan song, not a Jimi Hendrix song, brilliant as he was. Or others like "Lay Down Your Weary Tune," or "Mr. Tambourine Man," or "Knocking on Heaven's Door." Many different artists, such as The Byrds, Joan Baez, Sonny and Cher, The Hollies, Peter, Paul, and Mary, among many others, all recorded and popularized Dylan-written songs. Now, the following year, in 1964, his third album was released. It was called The Times They Are Changing. That album is a collection of ballads concerning racism, poverty, and social change that truly captured the upheavals of the 1960s. The songs often took up contemporary stories, with "Only a Pawn in Their Game" addressing the murder of civil rights worker Medgar Evers, and "The Lonesome Death of Hattie Carroll," about the death of a black hotel barmaid named Hattie Carroll at the hands of a young white socialite. On another note, "The Ballad of Hollis Brown" and "North Country Blues" addressed the despair brought on by the breakdown of traditional farming and mining communities. But of course, none of these songs exceeded the raw, table-turning power of the title track, which sees the moral and social push for justice, equality, and peace as part of a larger movement that is bigger than any of us, as old as the Hebrew prophets and declared by Jesus himself. With words directed towards society as a whole, towards writers and critics, towards politicians, towards mothers and fathers, it sums up the call to see the times for what they are in language that is richly evocative of the topsy-turvy kingdom called Jesus. "The line is drawn, the curse is cast. The slow one now will later be fast, as the present now will later be past. Your Kennedy in the late 1970s, and over a period of a few years released three albums of explicitly Christian music, the first being Slow Train Coming in 1979, which featured Dire Straits guitarist Mark Knopfler and was produced by veteran R&B producer Jerry Wexler. Wexler later related that Dylan had tried to evangelize him during the recording. Wexler replied, "Bob, you're dealing with a 62-year-old Jewish atheist. Let's just make an album." The opening track was Gotta Serve Somebody. That would go on to become another of Dylan's most familiar songs and would win the Grammy Award that year for Best Male Rock Vocal Performance. Though Dylan later backed away from the Born Again label and any close identification with the evangelical subculture, he never disavowed his Christian faith or his deepening spiritual and religious convictions. In his rich engagement with biblical language and faith remains evident to this very day. Now, for any performer who establishes their reputation so early on as he did, it would be a great challenge to continue staying relevant and fresh. But Dylan, admittedly with a few hiccups along the way, has managed to do it. His 1997 album, Time Out of Mind, marked the beginning of a renaissance for his career. And since 1997, he has released five critically acclaimed albums of original material since then, the most recent being just 3 years ago, an album called Rough and Rowdy Ways. It was his 39th studio album, released right after, get this, his 79th birthday, to overwhelmingly enthusiastic reviews. One of Rolling Stone magazine's musical critics wrote, "While the world keeps trying to celebrate him as an institution, pin him down, embalm his past, this drifter always keeps on making his next escape. On Rough and Rowdy Ways, Dylan is exploring terrain nobody else has reached before, yet he just keeps pushing on into the future." Now, he's also recorded a number of albums of older work, both traditional American standards, especially songs recorded originally by Frank Sinatra, and some of his early rock material smoothed into something a little mellow, in his album from just this year called Shadow Kingdom. He's also toured continuously and tirelessly since the late 1980s on what has appropriately become known as the Never-Ending Tour. Now, all this production and achievement, of course, has been rightly recognized and celebrated. Dylan has received numerous awards, including the Presidential Medal of Freedom, 10 Grammy Awards, Golden Globe Award, and an Academy Award. He's also been inducted into three Musical Halls of Fame, and the Pulitzer Prize Board in 2008 awarded him a special citation for his profound impact on popular music and American culture, marked by lyrical compositions of an extraordinary poetic power. Now, along these lines, and perhaps most remarkably, Dylan was awarded the Nobel Prize in Literature 2016 for having created new poetic expressions within the great American song tradition. Truth is, though many people were taken by surprise by this award, in truth, it's been for 20 years academics had been lobbying the Swedish Academy to give Dylan the Nobel Prize, with his lyrics having received detailed study from poets as early as 1998. When Stanford University sponsored the first international academic conference on Bob Dylan held in the United States. In 2004, Richard Thomas, a classics professor at Harvard, created a freshman seminar simply titled Dylan, which aimed to put the artist in context not only of popular culture of the last half century, but the tradition of classical poets like Virgil and Homer. But perhaps it was the literary critic Christopher Ricks, having written a 500-page analysis of Dylan's work, who said it best. He said, "I'd not have written a book about Dylan to to stand alongside my works of Milton, Keats, Tennyson, and T.S. Eliot if I didn't think Dylan a genius with and of language. His song lyrics, his poetry, in my view as well, deserve this attention. But as Dylan himself reminded everyone in his Nobel acceptance speech, he said, songs are unlike literature because they're meant to be sung, not read. The words in Shakespeare's plays were meant to be acted on a stage, just as lyrics and songs are meant to be sung, not read on a page. And I hope some of you get the chance to listen to these lyrics the way they were intended to be heard, in concert or on record, or however people are listening to music these days. I return once again to the poet Homer, who says, sing in me, O muse, and through me tell a story. And yes, through his songs, the story is told. The story is sung. How many songs have you heard that can match the simple, stirring power blowing in the wind? How many times must a man look up before he can see the sky? How many ears must one man have before he can hear people cry? And yes, and how many deaths will it take till he knows that too many people have died? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. Explaining some of where he was coming from on that song, with the melody inspired by an old African-American spiritual, and the image inspired by something that Woody Guthrie once said, Dylan related that the answer we're looking for is not in a book, or a movie, or a TV show, or a discussion group. It's already out there. The answer is already out there, but it seems elusive. It's blowing in the wind like a restless piece of newspaper swept around in a windy alleyway. But then, when it does come down, when it does come down, no one picks it up. So people don't get to see and to know, and then it flies away again. And that's the problem that, as Dylan puts it, that many people who could do something, who could get hold of the truth, are those who turn their heads away when they see wrong and know it's wrong. In this, Dylan implicitly understood what Jesus was talking about when he explained to his disciples why he taught in parables. That though seeing, the people do not perceive, and hearing, they do not listen, nor do they understand. Jesus recalled the word of the prophet Isaiah, for this people's heart has grown dull, and their ears are hard of hearing, and they have shut their eyes so that they might not look with their eyes, and listen with their ears, and understand with their heart, and turn, and I would heal them. But then, this is Jesus. All is not lost. For Jesus declares that good news is at hand, that a new day is coming, when eyes will be opened, and ears unstopped, and God's healing will flow like rivers of living water. That is what music, what great songs, can do supremely well. They can be a God-ordained means of divine presence and healing and inspiration and transformation, conveying the power of God in a way that no other medium can. Where we have been blind to what is in the music. I don't find it anywhere else. Songs like Let Me Rest on a Peaceful Mountain or Hank Williams' I Saw the Light, that's my religion. I don't hear rabbis, preachers, evangelists, all of that. I've learned more from the songs than I've learned from any of that kind of thing. The songs are my lexicon. I believe the songs. And so, I think so do we. And so we should. Great music, great songs, they are truly gifts from God. And Bob Dylan has lived a life by which something of this grace has come to the world in its full musical, poetic, and biblical dimensions. A grace that can transport us to a place beyond words from which we may experience encouragement, refreshment, and inspiration still today. To the glory of God. we approach our prayers of the people in the Lord's Prayer today, I would announce again that we are, especially right now, holding in prayer the family of Kathy Schindler. Kathy, very appreciative that you're here today, that you've led liturgy as you have. Many of you will remember that Kathy lost her mother about a week ago.
July 6th,
Charlotte Scripp. And Charlotte is going to be interred. Has the date of that been set?
July 28th
at Arlington National Cemetery in Arlington, Virginia. And so just know, Kathy, that our prayers are with you and your family. So let us pray. Gracious and loving God, as we come to you in prayer, we lay our hearts before you. We admit to you our own short-sightedness, our own blindness. But you already know that we think more of ourselves than our neighbors next door, let alone our neighbors who live around the world. We get so caught up in the needs in our own houses, we forget to think about, much less pray for, people whom we've never met. As we try to pray for starving children in countries we cannot place on a map, as we attempt to join in solidarity with women whose contributions are not recognized, as we are repulsed by the actions of those who abuse or neglect their families, the chasm between our quiet, sheltered lives and their lives in turmoil becomes clear. We struggle even to see the other side of the divide. How, God, can we believe that we know how to pray for such needs when we honestly have no idea what those needs really are? And so, humbled, we come before you now, placing our faith wholly in you, trusting that you know those needs which are obscured to our short-sighted eyes, believing that in your love and mercy you will reach out and touch the lives we cannot comprehend. As we pray, Holy One, we feel your call on our lives. As clearly as the disciples mending their nets and hearing, "Come, follow me," our souls resonate with the challenge to shift our focus. We know with every fiber of our being that you are calling us to be part, somehow, of your healing, life-giving touch, both in our own communities and around the world. Lord of life, may our squinting glance across the chasm of miles, language, and culture, our desire to see your will done on earth as it is in heaven, our prayer for our neighbors, not end with these words, but continue day after day, moment by moment, in our actions. Lord, we lift up to you people all around the world, people who are affected by war, by terrorism, people who have lost hope, people who are addicted to any substance. We pray for folks all over the world with all kinds of needs that you know. Lord, we lift up to you also those on our church's prayer list. We lift up to you today, Kathy, and her family on the loss of her mother, Charlotte. We also pray for Charles, Dory, Doris, Sarah, Wren, Evelyn, Don and Shirley, Susan, Deb, Bev, Todd, and the family of Heather Eads. We pray for Valerie, Green, Libby, and Robert. O Lord, may this prayer, through your grace, become for us a way that we are connected through your love with all creation. May our prayers transform our lives, and may all our words and deeds, all of our being, be an offering to you. So we pray in the name of the one who stands calling us, and who taught us to pray together, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven,
Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Hear the words of Jesus when he said, "Store up your treasure in heaven, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." And so with joy and gratitude, let us now offer our lives and the fruits of our labor to the Lord.
Jesus' hands. This we pray in his name.